Live from Washington, I'm Aisha Tanzeem, and you're watching Access Point. Hello and welcome. About 100,000 people waited hours in line to view Nelson Mandela's body in South Africa's capital, Pretoria, today. Over 100 heads of state attended his memorial service in Johannesburg this week. American President Barack Obama called him a giant of history. Mandela is so influential because his examples can be applied universally. So what can Pakistan learn from this giant of history? Let's explore. To talk about this, I'm joined in our Washington studios by Michael Kugelman, the Senior Associate for South Asia at the Wilson Center, and Raza Jan, Pakistan Team Lead at the American Enterprise Institute. And via Skype from Islamabad, we have Adil Najam, Professor of International Relations at Boston University. Welcome to Access Point. I was going to start from Balochistan, but news events are forcing me to start from Bangladesh. Pakistan's Interior Minister Chaudhry Nisar has expressed grief and sorrow over the execution of Jamaat-e-Islami leader Abdul Qadir Mullah in Bangladesh. He says this is tantamount to reopening old wounds and that Bangladesh should have moved on. So let me start with you, Mike. Is it possible to move on without some kind of reckoning, either by individuals or by nations?
Well, I mean, it's true what you said before, that Mandela's ideals are universal and should apply anywhere, including Bangladesh. And to hear this comment from a Pakistani politician that we're going to be opening old wounds, Mandela, of course, would have thought the opposite. You need to open these wounds. You need to re-examine what's happened and acknowledge them and then move on. And I think that, you know, if you look at a country like Pakistan, it's very similar to South Africa in the sense that it's very deeply divided, not racially, as South Africa was, but along religious lines, ethnic lines, provincial lines, linguistic lines. And so certainly, if Mandela's ideals could come to the fore, and ideally you'd have some sort of transformative, charismatic new form of leadership, hypothetically, that could try to move beyond those types of divisions. That would be ideal. I'm not saying that could happen anytime soon, particularly in a country like Pakistan, but certainly it's worth considering.
Adil, do you think Pakistan needs to go back and reopen this chapter with Bangladesh, or do you think enough time has passed that people can move on?
I think people should move on, but people should also understand history. It is a bit of a trivialization of Mandela, if you will, to sort of bring him, you know, bring every conversation down to a Mandela moment on reconciliation. I actually do not see the parallel in this case to Mandela's legacy. Mandela's legacy is really about opening your own wounds. It is really less about international relations and more about wounds within a society. And I think that's a lesson that all countries, not just Pakistan, but all countries can learn. Also, I think Mandela's lesson, you know, we think about it as reconciliation, but it's really about justice. And it's about a particular theory of justice, a theory of justice that is not based on vengeance, but which is based on an understanding of the other and therefore moving on. And I think that's a lesson, that's a very difficult lesson for any country to learn. And certainly it's a difficult one for Pakistan too, but an important one for Pakistan as for the rest of the world.
Well, Bangladesh is directly also linked, although, Adil, you think that international relations is not part of Mandela's legacy, but we'll bring that in and we'll explore whether some of the lessons can be applied or not. And Bangladesh is directly linked to Pakistan's relationship with India. But I want to bring in what you call internal wounds. That is Balochistan. Explain to me if something that Mandela did in South Africa can be applied in Balochistan, Adil.
I think, again, if you think about Balochistan, which I think is a very good example, the issue, again, is justice. The issue is not as much moving on or reconciliation itself. The issue is justice, but it's a particular type of justice in a society. It is justice not based on vengeance. It is a justice not based on settling scores. It is a justice not simply based on figuring out who did right and who did wrong, but figuring out how a society that is deeply wronged moves on. And that's what's different. You know, that's what's different when you're talking about societies rather than individuals. And I think that was the magic of Mandela. The magic of Mandela was that he understood. His challenge was not just to figure out what to do with the past. I think his magic was that he was very focused on what to do about the future. And that's what needs to be done in Balochistan too. Not by bean counting the past, but by building an edifice on which a reconciled future can be built. And that would mean for the rest of Pakistan to take a very deep breath and to ask itself some very, very serious questions. It would also take from Balochis and Baloch groups taking a deep breath and asking some very, very deep questions about their relationship with the rest of the Pakistani society and vice versa.
I think one of the things Mandela understood was that the problem wasn't just individuals, it was systems, and I think that helped him get over some of the hatred. We have an interview with one of his jailers. Let's listen to what he experienced when he talked to Mandela. Let's listen.
I asked Mandela one question. Don't you hate the white people of South Africa, what they've done to you? He said to me, Mr. Brandt, you know, I can never hate the white people. I can hate the system which was in place to put oppression and brainwash the white people of South Africa, because mostly my friends were all white.
So basically, not blame the individuals, Raza, but the systems in place. In Balochistan, the Balochis do blame the system in place. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that's the legacy of Mandela is that you need to have the truth out and then forgive, rather than forgive and forget. What do you think might work in Balochistan?
You know, in a situation like this, when you're talking about truth and reconciliation commissions, you know, like you had in South Africa, like you had in Rwanda after the bloodletting over there, I think there needs to be, the water sort of has to find its level first. The shooting has to, there has to be a desire for reconciliation on all sides before that kind of truth can come out. I'm not sure we're there quite yet in Balochistan, but I imagine, you know, people need to come to it on all, you know, come to terms with it on all sides, from the sides of people who are, you know, Balochi separatists or have sympathies with Balochi separatists, people who are, you know, basically backers of the administration or Pakistani nationalists.
Let me back up a little bit and ask you more about that point. We've recently seen our new defense minister, Khaja Asif, say again and again, I'll stand up for Balochistan. He said that when he was in opposition, but he was asked again when he was in power, and he said, I still speak on behalf of the Balochi people. We have to do it. Mm-hmm. We can't let another Bangladesh happen. What do you think is missing from when you say, we're not there in Balochistan? What elements are missing?
When you're quoting Minister Asif and he's saying things like, we can't let another Bangladesh happen, these are words they're using, and they use Bangladesh to contextualize what they're trying to avoid in Balochistan. But I don't think there was ever really a reconciliation process with regards to Bangladesh. And as we mentioned earlier, and as Professor Najib mentioned earlier, you know, Bangladesh became an international relations problem because of the schism, but we never addressed it in terms of the domestic hurt and the fact that there was a schism essentially with a sibling.
Within Pakistan.
With the enormous bloodletting that happened both in Pakistan and in Bangladesh. I remember growing up in Pakistan, going to school there, and the history books that I read, and it being so, you know, vastly different from what you realize growing up and going out in the world and realizing exactly what happened and just exactly how much more traumatic it was. I don't think, you know, and for somebody who, you know, gets, you know, foreign education or a private education, it's very different for the vast majority of people, probably even for the vast majority of, you know, people who are in power, people in the military, just common folk. I don't think there's a realization of exactly just how bad it was. And until you understand that, I don't think you can engender that true fear of what another schism would look like in a place like Balochistan.
Do you agree?
Yeah, I mean, effectively, yes, I do. I mean, as an American, I don't pledge to try to represent the views of Baluchis in what is a very complicated conflict and insurgency, a very domestic affair. But absolutely. I don't really have anything to add.
So, Adil, here we have guests who are saying that we need to kind of go back and reopen the old wounds in Bangladesh, if only to understand what went wrong and what not to do in future, rather than just moving on. Do you think it's too hurtful to reopen those wounds, or do you think it's helpful after such a long time has passed and people can actually look back and say, we need to learn from this?
I think the Bangladesh and Pakistan both need to confront that history. And history is always constructed, all countries constructed.
Let me quickly interrupt you here. And while you're answering that question, also tell us how or if any of those lessons do apply to Balochistan. Can Pakistan learn from Bangladesh and apply it to Balochistan?
I think the analogy, I'm uncomfortable with the analogy. And as I said, we also do not want to trivialize what Mandela did here. That was a very complex issue, as are these. He didn't leave us a blueprint that whenever you have a problem, call a Truth and Reconciliation Commission. We've actually seen that many of the ones that were called after that have not worked because they did descend into being blame games. They did descend into sort of a charade where people kind of knew who was the bad guy and who was the good guy. And that's where, again, the Mandela genius and what makes him special and all these sort of wannabes not be Mandela is that his issue was not about forgiveness. His issue was not about figuring out right and wrong per se, but was focused on the future, building a better future rather than rectifying a bad past. And neither Bangladesh nor Pakistan has done that, and I think Pakistan certainly needs to do that. Pakistan has sort of taken on mostly a silent mode on Bangladesh. People actually don't talk about it. They don't talk about it in a bad way, nor in a good way, nor in any way at all. Sort of come December, there'll be a little talk about it. Beyond that, we've ignored it. Bangladesh, much less so. But if you are really going to learn from Mandela, then both Bangladesh and Pakistan need to confront those stories. You know, for those of us, like, and I'm sure you've done the same, who watched hours and hours and hours of tape of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, what was striking was how there were these stories from all sides.
Exactly.
Of horrific things, right? And that's where societies need to come. And again, with Balochistan, I think if we make a Truth and Reconciliation Commission simply sort of a band-aid, that is not going to work because the wounds are too deep. The distrust is too deep. Essentially, as I said, it's about building justice, and justice comes when you've built trust. The reconciliation comes not because the guy who did bad has been shamed, but because there's a sense that now you can bring closure to the part of history that was bad and therefore start building a new history of the future. And unfortunately, we do not see that in international affairs or national affairs. Mostly those are concerned, again, about pinning the blame on someone, shaming someone. And that's how, for example, a lot of these things that worked in South Africa did not work elsewhere when they were tried. So simply calling a commission is not going to do it. This is a societal issue, much more than a procedural one.
Okay, let me then, if there is to be movement towards future, as Adil suggested, let me then emphasize on one part of it, not calling a commission, but at least bringing the truth out. We see in Pakistan, and a lot of states do that, all states, in fact, do that. They remold history to fit their purpose. But in Pakistan, there seems to be more of it than necessary. I mean, for Balochistan, it starts from the beginning. Pakistani children do not even know that in 1947, at the time of independence, Balochistan wasn't part of it. Michael.
But Balochi children are also Pakistani children, right? So I just sort of think, when you make a distinction between Balochistan and Pakistan, that's where reconciliation begins. The first thing is we realize, whether you are in the Punjab or the frontier or Gilgit or Quetta,
exactly, that you're a Pakistani. So, Michael, what I want to ask you is, where do we start in Balochistan? Both sides have inflicted pain on each other. There have been atrocities from both sides. On one side, you have the state, of course, which is more responsible. But then at the end of the day, you have these individuals of state who are following orders. Where does one start?
I think you need to go back even further and start with the question of education. There needs to be a better effort to make sure that people in Pakistan, whether in Balochistan or anywhere else in the country, know exactly what has happened in Balochistan. And of course, really, ever since the 1970s, the educational system in Pakistan has changed to the point that curriculums tend to promote a particular point of view, a particular message that's very dominant in the majority of young people in Pakistan are exposed to this type of message. So really, and this goes back to what we were saying earlier about getting the truth out there and knowing what really has gone on. And this doesn't apply only to the case in Balochistan. It applies to the treatment of religious minorities in Pakistan and what religion really should be about. That's where you need to start, in education. And again, this goes back to what we were saying before about this not being just the story about personalities like Mandela, what he did, and what actually is happening on the ground, but institutional factors, systems factors, and the educational system being a really critical factor here that I think would need to be brought to the fore if you want to talk about looking forward, moving on, reconciling, etc.
One thing that Mandela also understood, again, beyond this truth and reconciliation, is you could have high ideals, but you need to institutionalize them into laws, into a constitution. Mm-hmm. But talking about Balochistan, Reza, why is it important to tell the truth? I mean, all countries manipulate the truth to some extent.
Right.
What's wrong with Pakistan doing it?
I don't think it's a viable way for you to run a state that's, you know, multi-ethnic and, you know, it's got many sects and people from all sorts of different backgrounds, and especially in places where you've had, you know, a history of violence, a history of persecution, and you're trying to prevent a larger schism from taking place. I think you need to give people a sense of justice. And justice can't come as the benevolent gift, you know, as a benevolent gift from above. It can't be the National Finance Commission has suddenly increased and we're going to basically throw more sweets their way. That doesn't engender, you know, a sense of, you know, endearment to a state, a system, a country, a Pakistan as a people rather than as a collection of different kinds of people. There needs to be a sense of justice. There needs to be a sense of predictability with how one lives and how one relates to the state. And, you know, coming to the, you know, the system needs to find its level. Then, you know, once the wounds are no longer so fresh that people can talk about it, there needs to be then there needs to be a truth moment to basically cause to bring people together. You can't, when you have things like war or, you know, apartheid on the scale that you had in South Africa, or killing that you had on the scale in Rwanda, or, you know, insurgencies on the level that you've had in Pakistan, you know, at that point you can't throw everybody in prison who's, you know, been a wrongdoer. You've got, you know, for example, right now, you've got thousands of people who are detainees, you know, Taliban insurgents or Baloch separatists. You know, at the end of the day, you know, the army has justifiable reasons for, you know, not wanting to let a lot of these people back out on the street, but you can't incarcerate this many people because it just doesn't work as a system. I mean, if you criminalize all of society, then it leads to a breakdown of the system laws, because people don't, you know, if people feel they're unjustly, you know, accused, or if everybody's guilty, then no one's guilty. And so there has to be some sort of system where, you know, there's a way for everybody to be able to air out the grievances and come to terms with it and then move on with life. Part of the way I think they're doing it in doing it with a system of justice and trying to entrench that system of justice is the way that we have right now, recently with the Supreme Court taking, you know, vigorously taking on the case of
the missing people,
but going further back, election rigging in the 1990s,
right.
Coming to terms with the fact that there were injustices done upon the state, perhaps in this way, not in a violent sense, but there were injustices carried out upon the state. And even if these don't go anywhere in terms of convictions, And yes, you know, one can
at least it corrects
acknowledge
the record
exactly,
of history
acknowledges
and,
that there's
and
a retributive factor to it, but you're addressing
throw,
some of the problems.
Let me throw Adil another question out at you. What is the fear of the state of Pakistan? Why is truth about Balochistan hidden under the carpet? Is it the age-old question of a security state not wanting its dirty laundry in public?
So I hope this is not misunderstood, but I really actually don't think that the state tries to hide the truth on Balochistan. I don't think that's the problem. I think there is, very similar to Bangladesh, a lack of interest in Balochistan. This is not a massive conspiracy to hide the truth as much as not having systems to fully engage all of the country as a country.
But a lot of...
So this is neglect as much as it is sort of truth hiding. And that those bridges, those wounds need to be healed. And therefore communication is important. So yes, there are truths that need to come out. And there needs to be truth coming out on all sorts of things, not just Balochistan, but all sorts of things as in all society, but certainly in Balochistan. But I think, again, going back to Mandela, we would be doing a mistake if we start the process from figuring out who's wrong and who's right.
Right.
Rather giving the space for society to come back together. Mandela became Mandela because society was ready for him to become Mandela. Society had made a decision that what was happening could not continue. My own sense is Pakistan has made that decision too. Now, however, only making that decision, you talk to any Pakistani, even those in government, even those in the state, everyone has understood that what is happening is untenable. What Mandela did was it took a society where everyone had decided that apartheid was untenable and gave them a path out of that untenable present into a tenable future. That is what has not happened in Pakistan. I do think that one of the things that's common between South Africa right before Mandela comes out and the Pakistan of today is there is a clear sense in society. And you hear this from government, you hear this from the military, you certainly read it on newspapers every day, you hear it on television. There is a sense that what is Pakistan is not workable. Now, if it is not workable, the problem is no one knows what's the way out of the unworkability towards something different. And that is where the magic of Mandela, as I keep calling it, comes in, that he gave his country a path out of that unworkable present. That is what is missing in Pakistan.
So let me just throw something completely different in there. Do you think this trial of General Pervez Musharraf, Pakistan's former dictator, is kind of what Adil's talking about, a path, given a path to the country out of it? There's a sense out on the street and in the policy circles, even in Pakistan, that at the end of the day, Musharraf, even if he's convicted, like General Aslam Beg, will not suffer the consequences, but at least there'll be some reckoning. What do you think?
No, I don't think this is a particularly useful example, just because when it comes down to it, I think this is a political vendetta
okay.
That's been ongoing and really is a politicized process completely. I think that Nawaz Sharif, if he didn't have the history that he did with Musharraf, this may not have happened at all. And given all the other things going on in Pakistan, all the other challenges, the fact that this trial is happening now or is expected to happen, I'm suspicious.
I agree with you. There is a retributive factor here. Nawaz Sharif, his history with Musharraf. There's also, I think, a political expediency to it. It's a useful distraction for
right.
when you've
yeah.
got a lot of other problems going on. That said, and I don't think it contributes to truth and reconciliation in that same sense. This is not a Mandela-esque situation by any means.
No, but moving forward, I'm just going to ask you, because you
sure.
guys both seem to think there's some kind of political vendetta going on here.
There's still a use to it.
But I'm saying, would there not have been pressure on Nawaz Sharif, especially when General Musharraf decided to come back to Pakistan? And there was the lawyers' movement and remnants of that. There were the opposition parties. Do you think that he could have let it slide?
I think if you wanted to avoid the political football, so to say, of dealing with Musharraf, by now he's had ample opportunities to sort of he was cleared. He was bailed in all the cases. Drop his name from the exit control list. He'd
let him
very
go.
Likely leave. There've been chances to defuse it, but like we mentioned, there's probably a grain of revenge in there. It's politically very expedient, but it also serves a purpose. There's a Supreme Court that has sort of been chomping on the bit to get after him. It does serve a useful purpose in terms of just sort of establishing the rule that this sort of thing doesn't go unpunished anymore. So it helps in terms of trying to establish and cement institutions. Probably the way that's going about it, there's going to be a lot of distaste in a lot of people's mouth because of the angles that people can play into it. It has a purpose. I don't think truth and reconciliation
is
that
of it,
purpose,
but
there, I think I think something useful will still probably come out of it if it's done properly.
Adil, as you say, the lesson is how to move forward. Do you think Musharraf's trial is helping there? Because some people in Pakistan say that the civil-military relationship and the military's dominance of that relationship is the big problem behind Bangladesh, behind Balochistan, and behind a lot of other issues that Pakistan is facing.
You know, I absolutely do not know. And as I said, sort of my discomfort is trying to apply Mandela to today's headlines. That's not what that was about. You know, I went back to when Mandela came out, and I was sort of like the whole world. We were all spellbound by what was happening. But if you read the newspapers then, including on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, a lot of people were saying, well, this is not real. This is political expediency. I'm not making a parallel. What I'm saying is that what was happening there was not a case-by-case application, but a societal decision to turn. It is also, I think, wrong to reduce Mandela's legacy to simply Truth and Reconciliation. That was only a part of it. The other part, as important, was Mandela's optimism. It worked because Mandela started from the premise that all of South Africa can have a better future. The Truth and Reconciliation would not have worked without the believability of that optimism, of that hope. His message to his country was, look, guys, we're going to go through this very, very painful venting process. This is going to hurt. You're going to cry. I'm going to cry. We are all going to cry, but it's going to be worth it because a better tomorrow is possible. Unfortunately, all the examples we are talking about are still wrapped in that vengeance. And in some ways, I don't think we can figure this out in the moment itself. The positive news is, to me, that the angst that you see in Pakistan society, the positive part of that angst is that this society has also come to the realization, or is coming to the realization, which is very similar to the realization in South Africa right before Mandela, which is the realization that this state of affairs cannot work. Now, you have two paths here. One path is squatting flies, which is what we are doing. Try one guy here, do one bit there, give a little more money here, and sort of, you know, the regular political stuff. That's the more likely one. The other, the grand lesson of history that we can learn from Mandela is to take that larger path, that greater path, that path towards what Mandela was. But then you need a Mandela.
Well, we may not be able to learn from the Truth and Reconciliation part of Mandela's message, but there's one thing that maybe Pakistani politicians can learn from him, which is stepping down when he thought it was time to move on.
Yeah.
A lot of Pakistani politicians tend to think that if they're not at the helm of affairs, all hell will break loose. That was General Musharraf's biggest thing.
Can I, very briefly, I'm sorry to take too much time, go ahead. I think here is the big headline from Pakistan this week that no one is talking about. In less than 200 days, you know, in Ukraine, a country is falling apart. In Bangladesh, all politics has gone downhill with the current election issue. In Thailand, you see people sort of demonstrating around a transition. In Pakistan this week, what happened is that in less than 200 days, a prime minister changed, a president changed, a chief justice changed, and a chief of army staff changed, and they all changed through process. This is not about who did it. Society itself has kind of given them all the signal, hey guys, enough of that old game. This, I think, is dramatic. And that, I think, is also a salute to Mandela in some small way.
Okay, very briefly, in 20 seconds each, Michael, starting with you, do you think, as people say, if democratic process continues, it'll take care of everything by itself? And do you see that happening possibly in Pakistan?
Well, no. I mean, there are a lot of challenges ahead. Certainly, as Dr. Najam said, things have changed a lot from how things were in Pakistan a number of years ago. 18th Constitutional Amendment has curtailed the power of the presidency and devolved power. This is really important. This is democratization, institutional democracy. It's essential.
But challenges remain.
Absolutely.
Brother, 20 seconds.
I think Dr. Najam was on the money. This is, you know, this is landmark. But we've had such changes in the past. It's, can we repeat them? Can we have this happen again? And, you know, the old rule of thumb, was it two changes or three changes of democratic government, then you've got a cemented institution? I do think democracy can fix all it's going to take its time.
If only it continues.
It's going to take its time.
And military usually comes back after every 10 years. So let's hope this time it continues. Thank you so much for joining us. I don't even have time to thank all of our guests by name, but thank you for joining us. And we look forward to having you again next time for another episode of Access Point.